Hello, my name is Father Rolf Hermann Lingen. I'm a Roman Catholic priest, a so-called sedevacantist. Today is January 8, 2018, and today I've written a text, Baptism of Desire, Baptism of Blood, Heresy, the necessity of water baptism for salvation. Question is, can baptism of water be substituted by baptism of desire or baptism of blood? Or is the possibility of baptism of desire, baptism of blood, a heresy? Now, let's answer this question. First, look in a catechism. I have this Catholic catechism written by Joseph de Arp. De Arp is spelled D-E-H-A-R-B-E. De Arp lived from 1800 to 1871, and his catechism became standard in Germany until 1955. It was further edited after his death. And here, this is the German-English edition from 1892, and concerning baptism, we read. Baptism is the first and most necessary sacrament, because without baptism no one can be saved. Baptism is given by pouring water on the head of the person to be baptized and saying at the same time the words, I baptize thee in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. When baptism by water cannot be had, it can be supplied by baptism of desire or baptism of blood. Another example. This time, the Moral Theology, originally written in German by Heribert Jone and translated into English by Urban Edelman. This is the edition of 1948. And there, baptism of water is necessary for the attainment of salvation as an indispensable means for reaching that end. Only in exceptional cases can it be substituted by the baptism of desire or of blood. Baptism of blood consists in suffering death for Christ. The baptism of desire consists in an act of perfect contrition or perfect love, which acts somehow include a desire for baptism. Neither the baptism of desire or of blood imprint an indelible character. The obligation to be baptized by water still remains. The teaching of baptism of desire, baptism of blood, is nothing new. For example, look at the Summa Theologica by Thomas Aquinas in the third part, question 66, article 11 and 12, where Thomas quotes other authorities, for example, Saint Augustine, concerning baptism of water, baptism of desire, and baptism of blood. In the 16th century, the Council of Trent declared concerning the necessity of baptism that justification is not possible without baptism or the desire for it. In Latin, sine lavacro regenerationis aut eos voto, votum, the desire. So that's the teaching of the church, and for example, in the breviary of the priests, there is a small biography about the saint martyr Emerentiana, where we read Atuc catechumena proprio sanguine baptizzata. When she was still a catechumen, she was baptized in her or by her own blood. You could say that not every biography in the breviary is historical. That is true. But the point is, this is the assertion that someone who has not received baptism of water can be saved nevertheless. And in the canon law, Codex Juris Canonici, from 1917, there's a paragraph, a canon, 1239, and I found an English translation by Edward Peters of this canon 1239, paragraph 1. Those who die without baptism are not to be accorded ecclesiastical burial. Paragraph 2. Catechumens who, through no fault of their own, die without baptism are to be reckoned as baptized. Paragraph 3. All baptized are to be given ecclesiastical burial unless they are expressly deprived of, same by law. So that's the canon law. Of course, you can easily find information on baptism of blood, baptism of desire in the typical theological standard works, for example, Tanqueray, that is completely written in Latin, but of course German theologians like Diekamp, Polegierens, Prem, it's very easy to find, but it's nearly impossible to find an opposite position. But there is one, and this is the position of Leonard Feeney. Feeney, a priest, publicly denied since 1947 the possibility of baptism of desire and baptism of blood. So the Holy Office explained the Catholic teaching on this topic and wrote a letter to the Archbishop of Boston. You can find the original Latin text of this letter to the bishop in the Enchiridium Symbolorum, but it's very easy to find information on Feeney and the so-called Boston heresy case. When the Holy Office wrote this letter to the Archbishop of Boston about baptism of desire and baptism of blood, they explained the Catholic teaching. They refer to the Council of Trent. And then Feeney stated that the Holy Office itself is heretical. As a consequence, Feeney was excommunicated by Pope Pius XII. And Feeney later became a member of the group of Vatican II. That could come as a surprise to some people, but truth is, Feeney was a forerunner, in a way, a forerunner of Vatican II, because the spirit of Vatican II is rebellion. The spirit of Vatican II is lying. And Fine, by saying that the position of, or the teaching of baptism of desire, baptism of blood is heretical, was a liar. And after Vatican II, Fine became a member of Vatican II because this is the same spirit, the spirit of rebellion. For example, I myself was sentenced by the Vatican II group in a public trial. I was sentenced of heresy. And I asked, what heresy did I say, did I utter? And they couldn't answer this question because I did not say any heresy, but they only said, Vatican II is a dogma, so you say Vatican II is not a dogma, so you are a heretic. Of course, that's absurd, but this is the spirit of Vatican II. Rebellion, lie. And whenever nowadays someone says that the position of baptism of desire, baptism of blood is heretical, this person himself is acting in the spirit, in the so-called spirit of the Second Vatican Council.